about the mind, I think it is wrong. So you should just basically assume that if you want to have a predictive, you know, successful career, you're better off investing in certain ways of approaching the subject rather than in one specific hypothesis or the other. Right? This is not like Newtonian mechanics. Or, you know, of course, Newtonian mechanics is also wrong. But it took a long time for us to figure out it's wrong. And even when it is wrong, it's right about our macroscopic world in certain ways that is still important. But that's not the way neuroscience is going to be wrong. Neuroscience is going to be wrong in the way that phlogiston was wrong, right? Which is that nobody reads about phlogiston. Okay. So given that, what is the perspective that we should take to study the mind? That's really what this summer school is about, and I'm going to show you that despite flawed assumptions and various mistakes, the computer model of the mind was profound in the way that it shifted our understanding of how the mind works. Right? That's, in a sense, the single biggest shift in understanding how the mind works in the 20th century. And you could argue that Freudian psychology and computational psychology, to give the two alternatives, are the real two big major shifts in the modern era in how the mind works. Okay? Freudian psychology was the first psychology that tried to bring out the unconscious character of the mind. And of course, computational psychology took that on as well. But computational psychology made that much more precise and, let's say, mathematical in a way that Freudian psychology obviously was not. And so this combination of mathematization and unconscious processing, which are the foundation of everything that we now sort of automatically think of as brain or mental processes, is a very dramatic shift in our understanding. But it again has to be combined with the original starting point that I mentioned. Our experience of the world is not unconscious. It's the definition of consciousness is that we're experiencing it. So if at some stage you have to match this three-dimensional shape, form, vision, world with all of these accounts of tacit, unconscious, internal processing, you're going to face a problem sooner or later, right? And that I'll mention briefly towards the end of this lecture on why these computational models are problematic. But a lot of what is happening now in embodied cognition is really bringing back the importance of experience again into the study of the mind. Right, so this pendulum, which in the 20th century swung away from consciousness, so swung away from first-person experience, is now coming back in important ways into the study of the mind. Right, so that pendulum is what I really want to describe. Because for most of us, again, like what does Descartes say? A famous statement that he made, cogito ergo sum, right? I think, therefore I am. So first person experience, the experience of thinking is the foundation of existence. So he's saying that without experience, I don't even know whether I exist or not. Right? So it's only through experience that you know existence. So it's a very strongly subjective perspective. And it's interesting that Descartes arrives at that from trying to establish the objective foundations of science. Descartes starts by saying, I want certainty. Okay, so he says that in order for something to be really science, to be really knowledge, I have to be certain that it's true. If it could even potentially be, and this is his innovation, we all understand that for something to be knowledge, it has to be true and it has to be robust. If it is false, obviously it's not knowledge, but even if it is true, but it is not robust, it can't be knowledge. Okay. You could argue that, in fact, something that is not robust can't even be true. That's a separate matter. Okay. I mean, there are interesting thought experiments that challenge this intersection. But What's interesting is Descartes says, I want solid knowledge, and solid knowledge has to be certain, because without it being certain, it won't be robust enough. So he has the most extreme bar on knowledge. It's not 97% certain, it's certain, 100% all the time. There's no probabilities there. And so when you pose that as the fundamental constraint, and Descartes goes through various arguments, and he says the only thing you can be certain about is your own experience. Because everything else, something could be fooling you. So you might think the sun goes around the earth, actually the earth goes around the sun. You might think that, politician X is the most honest person in the world, it turns out that he has been on the take for the last 50 years. Whatever it is, you can't control that. It is, at least in principle, subject to violation. But Descartes says that my own consciousness is the one thing that even in principle is not subject to violation. Like, you can tell me that you are actually seeing a snake when you're seeing a rope, or you're seeing a rope when you're seeing a snake, but the fact that I am seeing a snake, whatever it really is, can't be doubted. You can't tell me that, no, you're actually seeing a rope when you're seeing a snake. You can only say that it is a rope, even though you're seeing a snake. But you can't tell me that my experience itself is that of a rope when I experience it as a snake. So I am the sole expert of my own experience. And by the way, that's where all of this comes from, right? That you are the first and last stop in the analysis, at least of a certain kind of your own experience. What it really is a separate matter, but as that experience itself goes, you are the first and only expert in that. And that's the foundation of this field. Somewhere, it always comes down to you being the sole and only proprietor of your own experience.
The statements themselves, I found quite attacking statements. On the one side, you say that in my own consciousness or my own conscious experiences, I'm not wrong. So I come as a subject. So you might tell a person that you're wrong, but he might not believe. Whereas you also say something about subjectivity, right?
So the what's interesting here is, let's go to the rope and snake. Right? I may say I might be really, really scared because I feel like I'm seeing a snake. You can tell me this is not a snake, this is a rope. But you can't tell me you're actually seeing a rope. Because as far as I'm concerned, I'm seeing a snake. You can't tell me that what you're seeing itself, you're not seeing. You can only tell me that you are, what you think you are seeing is different from what you are seeing. That's the claim anyway. Of course, our deep, so one of the projects might explore a little bit of that is perhaps even our experience itself is social. So which is to say, you can tell me not just that you are seeing a rope, you can even tell me you are experiencing a rope. Is that possible? Like that to say, somebody is more right about your own experience than you are. Is that even possible? Descartes thought that is impossible. Right. And we don't know. So the matrix is at the intersection of those two trends, so to speak. Right? That in the matrix, somebody could tell you that this is actually what you're really seeing. And they would perhaps be more right than you are.